And there we go. We got Tyler smiling. So welcome to Warhammer Weekly. We got Once Bitten with us today. Dylan and Tyler are here with us too. So we have a fun little outline to go through. We're going to stick to an hour if possible. Welcome back, Once Bitten. Anything to say or throw in?
No, thanks for having me back.
Awesome. Always a pleasure. So if you guys are ready, we could just jump right into some stuff that that we saw on Google Plus this week, some really cool modeling work.
Cool. Yeah, that sounds good.
Take about 10 minutes to look at some of this stuff. So, this is Inferno's Gutter. This guy has been doing some really cool stuff. He's working on some dwarf conversions. And let's see if I could find... So this was the one that he posted up. Do you guys recognize this guy?
Let me see here. Oh, yeah. Yeah, he just... he's been doing some awesome conversion work with his things, and he said he was inspired to go on like a painting tangent after like he had some good feedback from this site. And I gotta admit, his green stuff beards are pretty awesome.
That's the thing. So as we go through the photos, we see the beards. I didn't realize after they were painted that they were all green stuff.
Yeah, that's fantastic work. I don't know if you guys have any experience with green stuff.
I'm terrible with it.
Enough to know that I wouldn't do that.
Have you green stuffed anything once bitten?
Yeah, well, I've done enough to know that I wouldn't want to do a whole army of green stuffed beards. I mean, that's pretty impressive.
that's funny because it comes a lot with the dwarves. Usually, when people were converting their Chaos Dwarf armies, they go nuts making those crazy bearded guys. It just looks like a lot of work.
I'm curious as to why they're doing the green stuff beards. Was the first beard not good enough, or
this looks like too much like a dwarf? Probably.
This looks like this could have been a Iron Drake helmet, because Iron Drake helmets don't have beards; they've got like metal faceplates.
He might
have used the Iron Drake helmet. I'm not sure.
Oh yeah, and isn't there like a beard guard that goes down on their face or something?
Yeah, essentially. So if you wanted the more beardish looking look, you probably went for that. So these looks like he's making his own gunmen or probably his own Iron Drakes. I'm impressed with this. The thing is, though, they already have the Iron Drake model, so I'm not entirely sure what he was going for here. But he's got like these. Maybe he didn't like the goofy big cannons.
Yeah, it looks like him. Go ahead.
I was just asking, what is he doing? I can't quite see what the gun he's using for guns on those things.
I can't tell what it is either.
Is it
like thin straws? Something really thin.
Yeah, I was going to say, is it straws or is it like paper? Is he just using the cardboard paper or whatever?
I can't tell. It could just be a rod of some sort. But either way, it's got more of a gun shape than the Iron Drake guns have. They look like more like a blunderbuss.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
I kind of like what he's doing with that.
Oh, and then, yeah. And, you know, once it's a lot of work, but once it's done, you have it forever, you know? I mean...
And it's super unique. You know, no one else is going to have it.
Yeah, absolutely. And the dwarves, from building the dwarves, they get boring as hell. They're pretty static in their positioning and just the way they look.
Yeah, and like going back to what once been said with having the once it's done and is unique, it brings me back to Lord Inquisitor stuff. When I saw that at Brawlers, it's so cool looking that army, and how like nobody else is gonna have those guys. Has he done any other armies?
He has a demons army, but I don't. The only thing I remember being unique there was he had a bunch of the Slaanesh dudes that he just kind of built a portal and had them stepping out, so he kind of had them cut in half stepping out of this portal.
That's cool.
Which is pretty cool.
Really awesome. So this is just a dwarf body completely green stuffed up. Like, that's more work than I would ever be able to do.
Huh. Did he just cover the whole body with green stuff, or did he sculpt
his own
body?
I think that's 100% green stuff.
I'm pretty sure he's making his own dwarf body. But even so, I know this picture's sideways, I apologize, but even so, look at that green stuff beard.
It looks like a beard, but it could be taken as in the face is vomiting. I'm gonna throw that out there.
Once that's got paint on it, it'll definitely look like a beard.
A beard. Yeah, I agree.
A beard too. I hope that's the PSB and not just a regular standard bear, but it very well could be.
I don't know why these pictures are coming all sideways, but yeah, if you get a closer look at that, I can't tell what it is, to be honest.
So if this is a for the viewers, if this is a little bit difficult to see, you can just take your monitor or computer and just flip it sideways and then continue on with that.
Oh, okay, I see where he's going.
I pulled these right off of Google Plus. I don't know why they pulled them off sideways. So I apologize. We're almost done with them. But man, yeah, those beards, I don't know. I commend him. I couldn't
I like
do that.
How he's...
So this is the model that he finished painting. We'll go back to him in the beginning.
Yeah, and
go ahead.
From the Google Plus page, that was a custom Nord, one that he finished painting.
That was what?
It's a heavily converted custom Rune Lord using a hammer/longbeard body, Iron Drake helmet, and so on.
Okay. Huh.
I really like his additions with the green stuff on the armor, too. It's like something that wouldn't be necessary and that you wouldn't notice until it's actually done. And it's something that separates them from the normal dwarves.
Yeah, and that's why I appreciate that he has the pictures of the green stuff, because it's so well done you couldn't tell when it was finished.
Exactly.
So this is a sideways picture of a ballista, it looks like.
I almost think it's a bomb. It could be used as a mortar or something.
Well, if you can look at it, it looks like there's two dwarven cannons on the bottom ripped apart.
It's wicked.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I love that.
And it's got up the front. So that's some cool shit. But this wonderfully painted stuff, along with the green stuff work. I apologize, Infernus Gutter, for sideways pictures. But so that was his stuff. Let me see. I got Skull Crusher King, Tyler's favorite. This thing I took a look at today. I was very surprised and impressed with this. It's a Demon Prince converted with Throg, the Troll King.
Yeah, this is amazing. I don't know if I just saw this today, and he was saying, I don't know if it was a joke, saying that if Throg turned into a Demon Prince, but can he even turn into a Demon Prince? Does he have, like, Eye of the Gods on him?
I believe he can roll an Eye of the Gods.
Really?
I don't know.
Because if he can turn into a Demon Prince, that's kind of overkill. That's unnecessary.
He's making a model just in case that happens?
Yeah.
Well, I'll look it up while I quickly read an email from him. Hey, Nick, you asked me to tell you what I used to make the model. Sorry, the picture's a bit blurry. I put these on Google Plus page, but just in case you didn't read it, here's what I put. I used the wings and tail from a Warhammer 40K Hive Tyrant. I cut the hammer off of Throg's right hand and green stuffed it to the left hand in two parts. I made the shield from a sprue, and then the horns from the shield are actually from the chariot, which I picked up. I bought the base special, and I just took a small rock from outside. So I think that's pretty creative. And then I'll quickly look up Throg. It'll say in his entry, I'm assuming?
Yeah, he's got it.
Yeah.
He does?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
That seems like a little...
He's got the Iron God table, at least, in my own building.
Well, I think it'd be pretty crazy if he got turned into a freaking...
Demon Prince.
You know what? I don't think I'd even mind if he got that thing painted up and we played a game and Throg got turned to Demon Prince. I'd be like, okay, that's fine.
Yeah. So all your trolls, can they still use his leadership or not? That's my main question.
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like Tim turning into a Demon Prince might actually make him a little worse in ways.
How do you think?
They don't lose their items and stuff, right?
Oh, okay. Well, would he lose his like stats, like regeneration and stuff?
No, I think your stats just change. I'd have to check, but for the most part, you keep your equipment.
Yeah, because I remember you keep your equipment, but I didn't know about like special stats and stuff.
Right.
Because if it doesn't keep, then it would just make him a bigger target.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't wait to see that thing painted up. So this is our third submission. This is from the Warriors Vault. He's an awesome YouTube battle reporter. I think he just put up game 4 from Brawlers. So here are his... These are sisters, I'm assuming?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I would assume. He looked different without the blue bows.
I really like his base work, like the little tufts of grass.
Yeah, and he's got a variety of colors. He's got like a dead grass, a green grass, and then like some orangey fluff. So, and then I don't mind any feedback from you guys besides the sideways picture. Anyone watching, I am doing a different way of showing the photo, so I'm not using photo software, so I'm getting as much picture in as I can. I hope that looks better. But I don't know. Do you guys like the sisters in gameplay?
I'm gonna let OB do this one first.
Yeah, I'll let you guys answer that.
I've only played against them a couple times, and I think both times they were taken in a small unit, maybe 10. I mean, can they come less smaller than 10?
I think they can come in fives. I've fought them against units of five, I think.
Yeah, I think they might have been five when I played them. And so they were pretty powerful for such a tiny little unit, but they didn't take much to knock them out.
No, they're pretty easy to kill. I've just had some rough experience with them just because you have five or ten of them, and then they take off regen from a hell pit, and that's it. The bolt throwers go to town on any regen monsters.
Yeah, I definitely could see their strength being more towards armies of destruction.
Yeah, for sure. If I'm playing others, when it's not a big
and
deal.
Even when you bring them in the small units, the fact that they can strip regen with that, what, like Ballistic Skill 5, and then let the rest of the artillery take care of it.
I know Malorian had a big opinion on them when they first came out, and he was wondering why people weren't taking them more often, or he was talking about taking them in horde formation, just in typical Malorian
Hold
fashion.
On. Malorian talking about taking things in horde formation?
And
yeah, you get to that part of the rule book.
I was wondering how that would do, honestly, like a horde of sisters. That would be a lot of raining death, but if they got in hand-to-hand, they would break pretty easily, I feel like.
Is there a max unit size?
I don't know.
I don't think there is.
Yeah, but if you're fighting another High Elf player and they've got, like, Dragon Princes and, like, the World Banner Dragon,
run down.
It's just going to be two aboard saves across the board. So yeah, these are...
They've got the risk of running into something with any of the 2+ wards, right? Not even the Dragon Princes if they run against a Demon Prince.
Well, I think they're their arrows are magical and flaming.
Yeah, they are.
So these are some Silver Helms. I think these were the ones he brought to Brawlers. I'm not sure.
Did you play against him? I can't remember.
I was going to, and I was an asshole and ditched him, so Chris played him instead.
What?
But
you did what?
He was an asshole and ditched him.
My first game
ditched him.
You notice that's
what was that?
I didn't mean to detract. I just noticed that's a Demigriff halberd.
Oh really?
On that dude.
Oh yeah, that totally is.
Yeah.
This guy right here.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
The one with the halberd.
Yeah, that's it's way more intimidating than any other elf weapon. It like sticks out like a sore thumb now that you pointed it out.
It's cool that you figured that out. I can appreciate those.
Yeah, it looks great. I think. Yeah, I think the halberds are so pretty. I put them on some of my demigriffs, even though I never take a halberd, just because they look better.
So the demigriff riders can.
Anyway, that's nice.
Yeah,
well, sure. If they want a 2+ armor save.
There's another unit I feel the same way with, putting together some Skull Crushers or the Chaos Knights. The lances look so badass. And it's still, well, they're in Sorcel lances.
So that's the Warrior Vault. And to finish up on that, I was supposed to play a practice game with him, but my first practice game went long and I had to go eat. And I apologize, but he got a game in with Chris, so hopefully Chris gets that up at some point. So.
Was that, I don't mean to digress back, but was that like a hand-painted decal on there, or was it a decal?
That looked hand-painted. I think he does hand-painting. Especially for Brawler's Bash, I know the stuff needed to be hand-painted for it to count for good paint score. So, while we're on the topic, actually, instead of going right into Malorian's ridiculous questions, you were a paint judge this year, right? Once bitten?
Yeah, I've done that before, too.
Did you enjoy it? Because I know that you said it was a little bit time-consuming at times, too, though.
No, I didn't particularly enjoy it, but I don't want to make it sound like I begrudge doing it. I think it's I think all of us should help out.
Right.
And I was asked, and I was happy to help out. The problem was, you know, you're day one of the tournament, and you've played a game. You know you have an hour for lunch, and instead of eating lunch, you're trying to judge these paint things. And I don't mind judging them necessarily, but, you know, how do you find them? And then so the way I finally figured out how to find them is I went to the round one pairings on the wall, found the people for whom I was supposed to judge, and I would go to that table. And about a third of the time, they didn't have the name there. You know, so you're like, I don't know what army this guy plays. I just have a name, and he doesn't have a nameplate on it. So I tell you what, I did what I could. I worked all through lunch. Lorian showed up right as round two was starting with my lunch. So I'm like deploying and eating at the same time. I'm dripping, you know, this chicken sandwich juice all over my models. And there's about a third of them I didn't get to on my list, and I turned it into the TO and said, I'm done. I'm not, you know, I gave you my lunch on my first day, and the peckerheads that didn't have their name on their army don't get a score from me.
So, so is that something that you would plan for next year, potentially, to try and somehow streamline that and have a better setup?
Yeah, I think, first off, Ben went to a lot of work to try to make it a sound process. So he had, like, you know, the two TOs looked at every single army, and two players looked at every single army, but any given player only looked at maybe a quarter of the army, something like that. And I think that was well thought out. The problem was, yeah, there was no mechanism for how do you actually find somebody's army. Now, there was a point given if you had some kind of nameplate. And by the end of it, I was ready to say, there's no point. It's a pass-fail. If your name's not on there, you get a zero paint score. I was so mad by the time. I walked around the whole room.
So next year, what I should do is not only have, you know, a nameplate, but also have like a bagged lunch next to my army. This way, when you walk over,
I put your score a little bit. Yeah, if everybody just had little offerings. Like, not even a full lunch, just a little offering. So, like, you get three French fries each. Whoever's judging my painting score. Something. It was, yeah.
Here's a thin mint.
So,
and it was funny because I was using it.
Go ahead.
I was just saying, you know, there was a checklist, and some people don't like the checklist, some do. I didn't like, I like a checklist. I didn't like this checklist very much. I liked it okay. But it was funny because, so, like, Ben Mitchell, who's he's twice, three times the painter I am. When he was judging painting, he would sit there for 10 minutes. He's picking up models. He's looking close. He has a magnifying glass out. He's like, you know, is the blending perfect? I like look. I'm like, dip, done, out.
And that checklist isn't like easy to read either. Like, there's so much going on, right? Isn't it like each box is a little bit lengthy in terms of what they're expecting? Like, it's not like grade 1 through 4,
well,
it's like...
No, every item, like if it says, if you're going to give a score 1 through 4, every one has a description. And it's tough because a lot of times, you know, what you see doesn't match any of them exactly. But, you know, one thing that he did is he sent out the checklist to all of us paint judges a couple weeks ahead of time, and he sent pictures of three different armies with this is how, like, and Tom went through each of those pictures with the checklist, and he asked, he said, well, here's what we scored them at so that we all tried to get on the same page for how to use that checklist so that there'd be consistency in how we were scoring things.
See, that's
pretty impressive.
That's what my question was going to allude to, was basically how hard was it to differ between the two different, like, between an army and a different army? Because for us, when we're looking at pictures, it's like, there, it gets to a point where you're like, this is amazing. And then you go to another picture and it's like, this is also amazing. There's not much you can say about it. Did you find it hard to judge between multiple armies or just follow the checklist?
No, because I just followed the checklist. I mean, for most of them, I mean, if you keep your screen the way it is now, I mean, you know, so the I think that the top one there is the display board. And so is it just one flock? Is it multiple flock? Is it multiple flock and some kind of advanced painting with highlights and stuff like that? Or is it some kind of intricate diorama? So, I mean, I didn't find that very difficult. Yeah. And sometimes there's a huge mountain or, you know, a huge something, but it didn't wow me. I'm like, that's ugly. I mean, it, you know, there's no...
I've seen a real mountain. Yeah. That's not even impressive.
Yeah, that's not even dirt, please. And it was, like, model basing was funny. There were some armies that, you know, like a third of the army was beautifully flocked, and then another third of it was pretty much unflocked. And you're like, you know, how do I judge that? And I usually kind of round it down if it wasn't a cohesive, like, if that didn't all look the same.
How does the I was going to say, how does the model judging compare from this year to last year? Because I remember last year there was some, I would say, gruff with the checklist they had.
Are you just referring to Anthony complaining? Or?
Anthony and Malorian were stating their discomfort with it. Malorian was stating because he was on the same level as Once Bitten, but he didn't do as much as Once Bitten did. That kind of thing.
Yeah, is it still a component of overall Victor?
Oh, yeah, certainly. It was a huge component. You know, if you want an interesting conversation, sportsmanship affected it much more than painting. Hmm. I could tell you my painting scores out of... I think four judges, I had three of them give mine a 23, and one of them gave mine a 21. So, that's a lot. That's pretty consistent.
Sorry, what was it out of total for paint?
Well, I don't know how many. I'd have to add up. I don't know, because there's some points I knew I wasn't going to get. But to have three judges have the same score and one be pretty close to it, I think the checklist did a good job, and the preparation we did a good job of making sure it was somewhat consistent. My only problem with this checklist is that so model basing, if you look at that one, to get the third point, you need a diorama-like base with high attention to detail. And I'm like, dang, man. I mean, that favors somebody playing an ogre army, and that really screws somebody playing a night goblin army. there's no room on this basis. You have 8 million of them. But my big beef was conversions. I don't like if somebody bought everything right out of the box, assembled it, green stuffed it to fill in the gaps, painted it beautifully, they would get 0 out of 4 points because they didn't have conversions. I'm like, why is it inherently better? That really bugged me because I like to do some conversions, but you know, this is talking about doing things like what Lord Inquisitor did where you custom sculpt your whole damn army. Well, really? Is that what we're going to now? That if you don't totally customize your army, 4 points is a lot. I mean, 4 points is huge.
Yeah, it almost seems like it should get to the point where it should be separate from the overall score. Because, I mean, if you're going to be judging that, that makes it more like a painting competition, not the actual generalship. And that's kind of upsetting.
But you have one already for generalship, and you have one already for painting.
Okay, so
they overall is just combining both of them. I'm okay. I'm just saying that there's some aspects of this just really rub me the wrong way, mainly that. I don't think it's inherently better to have conversions, especially, again, 4 points out of... I mean, I can guarantee you, I probably scored a 2 out of that 4, so 2 points right there. And the painting score was very impactful on your overall score.
Yeah.
I was noticing that.
My thing about the conversions is that some armies are just better for converting. Agreed, or?
For sure.
Well, so if you're going to, let's say that you're playing a Monster Mash list, you're playing an Ogre list, you could convert that whole army with a fair amount of work. I mean, you don't have to do what Lord Inquisitor did and custom sculpt them, but you could do that. But again, you're playing a high model count army, and you want this extreme conversion, that's a lot more work. I mean, not even close.
Yeah. So. This is interesting because this actually leads into one of the other topics we wanted to talk about. I mean, it's kind of about the just, you know, your thoughts on Atomic Empire. I mean, I thought it was a great place. But this is your regular gaming place. And your take on Brawler Bash, what you would like to see different next year, or what do you think is being done well, or just the FLGS in general. Is it meeting your expectations?
Sure. Well, I mean, the game store is just fantastic. I mean, they do above and beyond what most game stores would do. So I have no complaints against them. I think one of the biggest ways that Brawler Bash needs to improve is in terrain. They have a lot of tables that are using cheap felt that snags on your movement trays. And a lot of the terrain, they have some great terrain, but I think every GT we have there, we should take a couple hundred bucks out and contribute to just constantly building better terrain. I mean, I think you have beautiful armies on the table and some really bad-looking terrain pieces on many of the tables.
And that'd be kind of an interesting addition to the pain score if you did add in your own terrain or brought your own terrain to the battle.
I know some tournaments that I've heard tournaments that do that. Is that something that you think should be included, bringing a piece of terrain with you to say Brawlers?
I've heard somebody throw out that idea because at the National Masters tournament, people were complaining about it, and they said one easy fix is have everybody bring something. That would be a fix. I don't know. I mean, I think there's a lot of ways to do it. I mean, again, it doesn't take much. A couple hundred dollars, especially if you're not buying really expensive terrain, but you're building, so you get some people with expertise and you just kind of build it. That goes a long way, man. You could get some really good terrain. Anyway, some of the felt pieces are cut poorly, and so
I really did forget some of them were there because, I mean, once somebody removes the one forest on top of the dark green felt, like, I just forgot it was there, to be completely honest.
Oh, and my Skaven Slaves are steadfast.
Well, going to... Yeah.
You just cover up the whole thing and you can't tell.
I do like that idea. People... Go ahead.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
I do like the idea of bringing your own terrain. I think that it's a cool idea, but you just got to feel bad for the poor Wood Elf player that's bringing the Acorn and has to carry like five pieces of terrain to the game.
You don't have to feel bad for that guy.
Yeah, really.
You know, one thing they're doing is they ask local player, like three of those tables were set up with my terrain. So in addition to Brawler Bash terrain, they ask local players if they can outfit one or two or three tables. So that helps out some. But even my terrain, I mean, I have those beautiful hills built by that dude who's out like in Eastern Europe somewhere. And Brawler Bash uses them for some of his stuff. But the hills are like 7th edition hills. They're like really small, and they don't block line of sight at all. And in 7th edition, that worked because hills inherently block line of sight. In 8th edition... there's almost no reason to have them on the table.
You get plus one combat use for charging down them.
What the plus one combat res anymore? Well, the expense was what, $35 to do the tournament? I mean, I wouldn't even mind paying $40, an extra $5, if I knew some of that money was going to go to terrain for the next year or something like that. Because I know we had a long hike down. But the GT that we usually go to by us, Crossroads, is like $70, $60 for the weekend. So, like, it was already half the price. But
yeah.
Do you feel like if you had it as a requirement to bring terrain, that it would lessen the quality of terrain? Like, people would be going out buying aquatic just terrain and bring it to the table or something?
Yeah, and I mean, I think there's a lot of people that just don't have terrain, and I wouldn't want to see it as a requirement. I mean, you know, that kind of sucks. Especially, they're still, even though it's a big GT, there's still a lot of people that it's their first tournament or, you know, their fourth tournament. You know, they're not guys that are stocking boxes full of terrain at their house like losers like me are. Yeah. You know, but the other interesting thing, and I haven't heard you guys talk about it much, but the way that sportsmanship entered into the overall, did you guys not notice that?
No, I didn't.
I just saw where I placed, and I just didn't look at it again. But
I saw that Anthony had a higher sportsmanship score than you.
That's beyond me. I don't. Anthony must have smiled that day or something.
Yeah. You just bought everyone a beer?
Well, think about it.
He gave people points. That's what he was doing. watch his battle reports.
Yeah, I feel bad watch for the battle reports. Player. Yeah.
Yeah. He's like, oh, I was crushing.
So it was as important, or you said it more important than the paint score itself?
I don't know about that, but it dropped me a couple places, and I usually consider myself not a bad guy to play against, but it was interesting because instead of just giving your opponent a score, like, hey, was he a great opponent, a good opponent, or a jerk, you had to actually rank them. So it could be that, let's say you played five people, they were all good games, right? Everybody's a good guy, but you have to rank them. Well, two people are going to get really low scores.
Yeah, for sure.
So I don't know. I think that if somebody was just giving me a score on a scale of 1 to 5, saying how was one Spitten to play against, and somebody gives me a real low score, like he was a jerk, I'm okay with that. I deserved it. But if you just have to rank them, and they're like, no, OB was fine, but you know these other guys, this one guy laughed more, and this other guy's a friend of mine, you know. I didn't like that a bit.
Why should somebody get the lowest because he could be a great guy but not the greatest of your five? Yeah, that doesn't seem quite right.
Yeah, but I feel like the ranking system allows for more diversity. Otherwise, so many people are going to get perfect scores.
Well, it's just buffering everyone. It doesn't really matter.
Yeah, why don't you do it like the painting checklist then? Say, you know, here's a detailed description of a 1 through 5. Because normally what people say is you give them a 0, 1, or 2, and you better give everybody a 2 unless they're a jerk. And so everybody just is like, yeah, he's fine. They give him a 2. But if you just said maybe a 5 is – or another way you do it is you do a 0, 1, 2, and then you say who are your two favorite opponents. It kind of does the same thing without forcing you to really – you know,
do you feel like the army you take changes the way like people rate your sportsmanship? Like if you're going to take like a net list, or people like, "Fuck you, bad sportsman."
Yeah, if you take something super cheesy, then you've already got a kind of bad attitude going into it. Almost, you could be a great guy, and you could take a list that's really tough and still be a great guy to play against, or you could be Nick.
Yeah. You know, if I was scoring everybody on a scale, I don't think the army you brought would affect it. But if I have to rank people first to last, yeah, that might affect it. You know, I played one. There, you know, two people were equally cool, but one brought a really fluffy list, and one brought a net list. I would probably rank the fluffy list higher if I had to rank them. Anyway, it's pretty impactful. There's one dude who went undefeated, but came in 95th place in his sportsmanship score. dropped him considerably.
Really?
Was he a good winner or a bad winner?
I don't know. I play him all the time. I don't have a problem with the guy. But I think he comes across in a way that might be intimidating for some. Yeah, I don't know. But, you know, that's... Well, they weren't playing around. But you know what that did is he and I have both kind of talked around, you know, both of us kind of said, wow, I don't want that to happen again. You know, it's like if I got a low sportsmanship score, that's like a real big deal for me. Like, I've never considered myself that player. But then I look around and I'm like, Jerry Parsley, if you ever watched that, you can't help but watch that guy play a game. If you're 30 feet away from him, he's louder than your opponent. He's always just cracking up, and he just talks real loud. He's kind of like narrating the battle, and it's just, it's funny. I don't have that kind of energy or that kind of creativity.
Especially not by game 5. So,
yeah. And if you look at it, he and I had very, very similar battle scores, but he took 4th place overall, and I took 14th place. Hmm. So I think he beat me in paint because he had a completely converted army.
Yeah,
and I think his sportsmanships were probably a lot better because he's just like this freak of nature. In terms of his energy, you know. So.
That's fun. Yeah, I don't know. I don't even know what the perfect tournament setting is in terms of points, but I think we're close though. But I don't know. I don't think sportsmanship should have played that much of a role in people's scores.
That's because you got a low sportsmanship, isn't it, Nick?
No. I don't even know what my sportsmanship score is. I don't even know how it was calculated. It was in like thousands of points, and I'm like...
Yes. Yeah. Like five games? That's a lot of points.
Like 4,000 points in like sportsmanship. But at least when we went to Crossroads, it's like you rate each opponent at the game, like 1 through 3. Would you play him again? You would definitely play him again or not play him again. And then you just give your favorite opponent at the end. And then some of that stuff just used as a tiebreaker. And like, I don't know. I'm not a TO, so I can't say. But do you guys want to move into Malorian's ridiculous questions?
Yeah, I feel like if we don't, I'm going to end up getting off track.
Okay. <Yeah. laughs> So these questions are for Once Bitten from Mr. Malorian. Question number 1. Was it hard to drop Team YouTube for Cobra Kai, or was it simple? Or was it simple, like breaking a kitten's legs and tossing it into the river?
Yeah, so you've already heard my story about that. First off, there never was a Team YouTube until we show up at last year's Brawler Bash and Malorian starts throwing that term around, Team YouTube. And then at the end of the tournament, he's like, well, I won out of Team YouTube. I did better than all the rest of you. And I'm like, oh, so this is a Team YouTube. This is competition YouTube. And this year, I whooped his butt, just for the record.
Yeah.
I was gonna ask how did you feel, like, what do you feel like you did differently this year from last year? Because you rank considerably higher this year.
Lore fire.
Yeah.
Lore fire, baby. Yeah. You know, I don't know. I mean, there could be some things, and it could just be. Last year's Brawler Bash is some of the worst luck I've ever had, ever. It was insane, and I griped about it in my battle reports, and I just finally just shut up about it. It was nuts. It was crazy. I think my list this year was also a more competitive list. So I think that's it. I mean, whatever. Sometimes it's the luck of the draw. Some, you know, last year I was so unlucky. I drew Anthony, and you know, nobody can beat that.
Monster Mash.
Dirty.
Yeah.
All right. Talking about monsters, here's a next question. If the new Bretonnian book had a new monstrous mount that was a giant kitten but had powerful rules, would you use it?
That would break its legs first.
And throw it into a river.
Yeah. How important is aesthetics to your choices?
I don't know. I've changed so much in that regard. I'm tired. I was tired of getting frustrated going to tournaments and playing net lists and not having the tools to deal with it. You know what I think would be fun? I think we should have like a revision of army books done by players, to where every type of unit in the book has 3 different sets of stats, right? And every time you play a game, you roll a d3. And that's when you find out what stats they're going to be. So not that they would be completely ridiculously bad, but you wouldn't have any choices that were auto-include. And then we could just put together an army that was built around a theme. Because you know what here's what I'm getting tired of. I'm getting tired of people putting together lists, the min-maxing, abusing it as much as they can, and they say something like, well, I don't like comp systems because if I buy the model, I want to use it. Like, shut the hell up. What? That is such bullshit. I get so tired of hearing that. I have the model, so I want to, you know what, you could use that model as a proxy for something else, but you don't. You happen to have the model that's the most overpowered thing in your freaking book. Shut the hell up.
God, how many models of, say, Marauders has he left at home?
Yeah. Well, it's funny how all of a sudden... Remember when demons in 7th edition were just so ridiculous? There was a dude playing in my area that had... He brought a list with so many pink horrors that his magic phase was like 24 power dice to your 3. It was ridiculous. And we were like, dude, you know, we've got to start comping something. This isn't fun for anybody. He's like, this is the list I want to play. I always like pink horrors. Like, well, you never used them before, and you don't use them since. Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, I get so freaking tired of that. I totally agree with that. I think a lot of it is people just go out and buy the model, and they're using that as an excuse. Because, I mean, what else? A lot of them, I don't know. I don't even know where I'm getting
that. I want to see someone justify their bad choice that way. Like, if I bring a Troglodon, like, I bought the model, damn it, I'm going to use it.
Yeah.
You know what? Respect.
I don't care about winning.
You know, I mean, because if we were doing it like that, where you didn't, where there was no single overpowered unit, or you didn't know which units might be better or worse, I mean, the reason I started Empire is I wanted an infantry-based army. You know, I have a cavalry army with Bretonnia. I want to see... I like the big unit of halberdiers. I'd like a big bus of swordsmen. I'd like to see two units of 20 great swords. I think they're just beautiful models. I would love that on the table. I can't win with it. You know, it doesn't win.
Yeah, instead of
so 40 two units of demigriffs.
You get it's better to just take four freaking demigriff riders than a whole unit of 40 halberdiers, pretty much now.
Well, okay, so help me with math. So how much are Demigriff Knights?
58 points? 56, 58, so somewhere around there.
Okay, so unit of four, let's say you're at 2.5, right? 250-ish. How many great swords can you get for that?
They're 10 points 20? Each.
They're more than 10. Okay. I think there are 11. Yeah. So you can get a unit of 25 great swords or four Demigriffs.
I put 21 great swords for them, and the demis will win.
Yes, straight up.
Not even close. Matter of fact, it's not even paper, scissors, rock. It's not demis will win. No, demis win against everything. Everything. It's not even close. There is nothing that 21 great swords will win against that four demigriffs won't.
We're going to have to bounce back to Balorian's questions later because this kind of is one of the things that I know we want to talk about, and it was the of trying different things and how forgiving Warhammer is. Because, like, I know you tried Lore of Fire, or, like, I took the bell and people gave me shit for it, but, like, do you feel like sometimes it bounced back? Like, how did Lore of Fire work out for you? Was it absolutely terrible, or were there some things that came along nicely?
Beat the elves.
It beat elves. Lore of Fire did... my impressions that I recorded with Malorian... I changed my mind after I did my battle reports, because when I was talking with Malorian, I was saying for most games it did nothing, but it, in a pinch with the elves, it did what it was supposed to do. When I was doing my battle reports, I realized in most games, it was nice to have. It was really nice to have.
Well, would it have been better to have than Lore of Life to regen your steam tank?
See, I didn't think so. I purposely didn't take life because I didn't care about keeping my stuff alive. I needed to kill your stuff.
Right.
And Dwellers Below was the only spell they had that was going to help me with that. You know, Shadow I'm a fan of, but it just, you know, I felt that fire synergized well with my list, and I liked that it was one little thing that wasn't quite the net list that, you know, I mean, my list is a variation of very few, you know, Empire lists you're going to see out there. And so at least something different. So I don't know, I think it's kind of cool. I think a lot of people underestimated the fire, and so they weren't worried about my magic phases. I was getting spells off, and you could tell they're like, you know what, you don't have anything else I'm worried about. And it's like, it can surprise you.
Yeah, it looked like it was useful to have that double flaming attacks options available to you. You're going to get one, either the warrior priest or flaming sword off, so that looked like it helped.
That was nice. Plus one to wound at least was a great threat on my Hellblaster Volley Gun against monsters. Anything against monsters. I think when I was playing the Tomb Kings guy, it doesn't really show up in the battle report because the spell didn't go off, but I forced him to use his Dispel Dice to stop that plus one to wound on my Hellblaster, because then it doesn't matter what your toughness is. I'm wounding on fives. And he just had to stop it, and it allowed me to get other spells I needed off. I don't know if I'm gonna bring it in my next tournament list, but
did you throw any level 3 fireballs?
I did.
Yeah.
Did it do anything?
I'm sorry?
Did it do anything?
It did. It did. I know that it, I think it was my practice game against the High Elf. I killed the rest of his White Lion unit, which was nice. So.
Yeah.
It's such a big jump between that level 2 and level 3 fireball. You know, because like fireballs go like 5 to cast, 10 to cast, 8 million to cast, something like that. It's a huge jump.
Yeah.
But it's 3d6 hits though, right?
Yeah. Yes. In that first game against the ogres, I cast the most boosted version of fireball, and then I rolled a 1, a 1, and a 2. Oh, God. And I miscast too. I'm like, damn.
So there is something I want to mention when we're talking about this, and basically the idea was trying different things and how forgiving is it. In a tournament setting, I feel like it's a way bigger risk, and depending on, like, you can't just go and proxy everything. If you're just trying to learn and we're trying to try something crazy out, and you can do a little proxy before you actually go out and buy it. But Warhammer itself doesn't really lend itself to going, oh, I want to try this quirky thing where I use 62 rat ogres. Like, you can't just do that.
I feel like if you do something like that, you have to make your list oriented around that. Like, if you do take special units and stuff, it has to be oriented around keeping that kind of stuff alive or working with it so it's more synergistic. Like, I can't take 40 chosen or 40 forsaken and just go into a battle just being like, okay, they're going to do their thing and it's going to be okay. They're not going to die. Because, I mean, with armor 4 plus, they're just going to be shot down by normal elves. So you have to kind of work around the special units you take. And I think once Ben would agree that, like, in comped tournaments, it's more forgiving, but in, like, hard tournaments like Brawlers, it's not as forgiving, or at least that's the way it seems.
Mm-hmm. I would totally agree.
Building your list around that crazy different idea is essentially what I did with the Lead Belchers, and it was a lot more forgiving than I figured it was going to be. I was going in expecting to lose most of my games because I was bringing 24 Lead Belchers, but the most forgiving part about it, or the most enjoyable part, was it just threw people off so much. And to go to a GT and just see people get flustered, even though I lost some of those games, just to see people not know what to do was so much fun, because like the High Elf player that ended up winning the entire tournament, I played him game one, and he was like inching back and forth, like he didn't want to commit, he didn't know what to do. And just the fact that I had the winner of the tournament like flustered, well, it was cool, it was fun.
But then he cleaned your clock, right?
Yeah, exactly.
I am flustered, though. Oh, he was flustered. Like, 200 Skaven saves, like, whoa, that's a lot of Skaven. Oh, wait, that's fine.
But, I mean, I brought something that did scare him, though, even though it wasn't, you know, the same old shit that you see all the time. Like, it was, he actually said he was more afraid of my list than he was a Gutstar list, just because 24 Lead Belchers against T3 Elves, he didn't know what to do. You know, he ended up doing all right, but...
I also feel like people train to play against the net list, so when they see a list that's just completely out there and that it's going against the system, I could see it definitely flustering some people.
I agree.
But I think the cost involved in this game doesn't really lend itself to doing those crazy things. Like, you can't just... It took you how much money, how much time to make that lead belt for? I mean, that was just one kind of crazy idea.
Zero.
Now, if you said, now I want to try using Yetis.
All right, well,
Yetis now.
Yeah, it's a different story.
You just have to proxy. It's a proxy.
Yeah, straight up. I'm not using straight up 40 chosen. I threw in some spawns there as space fillers because they're like $50 a box of 10. I'm not going to spend $200 to get 40 of them.
Especially if you don't even want them to have great weapons.
Yeah. But I'm also, I always do themed armies, I guess. I have a Viking theme army, and right now I'm working on a tree theme army. So it lends itself for them. It's more fun for me to actually use those kind of units. I don't know about you guys, if you wish you could use those units more.
Yeah, I wish I had every unit in the game with enough models that I could use them anytime I wanted to. That's an ideal world.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I always loved Minotaurs in a Beastman army. I was trying to find a way to build them into a list, and it's just, they just die, you know?
I feel the same about the Rat Ogres.
I'm going to make Rat Ogres work.
Yeah, that's exactly.
You're not going to make them work.
Yeah. I remember in your earlier games, you used great swords like you were saying and stuff, and you're really trying to get them to work. Do you think it was that one Brawlers that just made you rethink, like, okay, I have to readjust to fit the meta?
I think I just did the math and realized of my horde of great swords, I could have 2 units of 4 demigryphs, and I was like,
yes.
It's just not even close.
Doesn't it just suck though in a game of like checks and balances and like points that nothing is actual like even or equal? Like,
if you want to play a balanced game, you gotta play chess.
I guess so, but this is just a real complicated game of chess, and the fact that the demigryphs for your points, you'd rather get the demigryphs over the greatswords.
Game.
You know, with that D3 roll, I feel like you could actually lend that into the fluff too. Like, just say like roll to see how veteran your warriors are, or something like that. I think that'd be cool.
Yeah, yeah,
a cool compromise.
I think that'd be a fun system to do. Where just when you showed up, I mean, you know basically what things are, but it would allow you to bring other types of units.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
If you're going to go that route, we might as well just fix the books and figure out a formula for how many points everything would be worth. The internal balance is freaking ridiculous, the lack of internal balance.
Yeah, when 8th edition started, it seemed like it was pretty balanced, but would you say that it's definitely lost that balance now?
It's pretty good.
I think the balance between books is pretty good. It's the balance within books that's not good. I think Tomb Kings is very internally balanced, but sadly it's one of the worst. The armies are balanced.
Are you still looking at Tomb Kings once bitten?
I am. Actually, this week I spent time painting up a War Sphinx. Just starting to base paint it. I still want to. It's just, I've actually been burned out of the hobby lately. I mean, not that I'm disliking it. It's just, like, I have 3 battle reports ready to be made. The games are played, pictures are taken, and I'm just not making them. I just don't feel like it.
That was something I was going to ask,
too. And so, you know, the thought of it.
This is, lends on your topic. It goes to Nick, too. Like, you're getting burned out of the game. Do you think it's the big tournaments that burn you out? Just so many games? Or is it just the modeling aspect and just the game in general?
Dylan, this was supposed to be our whole topic last week that no one showed up for.
Well,
so I guess,
we have
they are burned out. But yeah, as a tournament player, when you're finished a tournament, you just want to kind of leave the game, don't look at the models for a while, or are you kind of focused up, ready for the next tournament?
It's been both ways. I would say most of the time. Were you asking me? I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. Most of the time, for about 2 or 3 days, I'm just done. I feel so nerded out. I want to go get some sunshine, drink a beer, do something manly.
Play sports.
Go play sports. It's like okay. Yeah. But then other times, especially if it went pretty well, and I think, oh, wait, I think I've got the meta figured out. I can't wait to plan my list for next time. Then it actually gets me really excited. But it wasn't just that, because I had a real fun game up in Pennsylvania. That's one thing I'm really enjoying about the hobby is kind of meeting and playing with people that aren't in my area. So when I went to Pennsylvania, I met up with Casual, went out and played, and then I attended a one-day tournament last weekend, and a dude was visiting from out of town and sent me a message. So he swung by, picked me up, we went to the tournament, hung out all day together, played a game, and it was a lot of fun. But even with that, I just found myself just, I don't know. I mean, I think the tournament scene is what draws me to it, and it's what pushes me away. Just the constant being tired of the same thing every time, being tired of there are some armies and some lists that are just inherently better, and you need to take that, or you're just not going to do well. And I just get tired of it sometimes.
I think there's a lot of stress involved, too, potentially, with these tournaments. If you actually want to go in and actually compete and perform, if you're making these battle reports, and maybe not so much for some players who are going to these tournaments that just kind of want to have five games in a weekend, but if you're going in, it's stressful.
Yeah, that kind of lends itself to, like, what kind of gamer you are, too. Because are you going to these tournaments for the social function, or are you going just for the fact you want to win the game?
Well, for me, this past time around was totally the social function, just to get down and meet people and play. I played, like, eight games that weekend, and that was fun and all. But, I mean, the other thing you got to take into consideration is whether we're a tournament player or not, being a battle reporter is like a whole other thing, because you're taking all these pictures during your game, so you might be enjoying them less, and you're thinking about all the games when you go to do the battle report. And it's just time consuming. So like that's where I kind of got burnt out for like the week coming home, because yeah, I wanted to do my battle reports and I did a few, but like I wasn't dying to play my next game. Like I was just happy sitting down painting again, to my surprise.
You know, it's funny because that's actually what I started painting. I haven't painted in months, but I find right now I don't feel like playing the game. I don't feel like preparing for the next tournament. I just want to maybe just paint and just get back to the hobby. I'd like to have an adjustment to where I go to tournaments just for the social aspect and just to play a greater variety of people, because I know I show up to tournaments and I'm expecting to do very, very well, and you know, normally I don't do as well as I want to do. Of course, what I want is really it's hard to do.
The one way I find myself detoxing or cooling down is kind of like that cool down lap after sports or whatever. I come home and I'll play smaller games or gradually move back down to like 1,500 points just so I'm still playing, but it's not the stresses of, you know, 2,500, 3,000. So that's how I usually, like the past two games I played were like less than 1,000 points, and it was just fun to play but not have the stresses of a big damn game that needs to work well.
Yeah, and then you just like skip out on Warhammer Weekly too, just kind of step away from the hobby for a bit.
Screw you.
I think the way the thing where I can relax back in the hobby is play some bigger games, like play some maybe 2-on-2, 8,000, 10,000 point games, because then you're using so many models. You're using so many models, you can't bring an optimized list. You have to bring the unoptimal stuff as well.
I was going to ask about that too. Do you feel like it's more forgiving at the higher point ranges? Like, I feel like that's what you're getting into.
I don't know if it's forgiving of what, but it certainly takes away from the net listing, because with the exception of Malorian, who owns enough trolls that he could make a 10,000 point game out of them, most people just have this huge range of different stuff. And so if I was playing my Bretonians, I would have, oh my gosh, I would have like 400 peasants on the table. I'd have my Grail Reliquary with all the battle pilgrims. Stuff that I actually spent a lot of time painting and would like to see on the table.
Okay, so. Sure. You just use your Beastmen if you don't want a competitive game.
You know what? I decided today I'm taking Beastmen to the next GT.
Yeah!
Sweet.
New book.
Good. Yes. I believe, like, watching your battle reports, I think your Beastmen are probably one of the most entertaining to watch. Every Beastmen battle report you put out, I feel like I've thoroughly enjoyed.
I just leaked.
You know what? He's pretty awesome. You know what? If you're ever bored, if you're ever really bored, like let's say you're at the hospital for a month, go look through all the comments of my battle reports, and what you'll find is if I'm playing with Bretonia, people will say, I wish you would play with your Beastmen. And if I'm playing with my Beastmen, people will say, you should play more with your Empire. And just...
everyone, just someone else.
Whatever I play, somebody wants me playing something else. I'm like, I've got 375 damn battle reports. Go watch the 250 to have an army. God.
Little disclaimer at the end of the video.
The Beastmen are. I'm saying it now. Beastmen are.
They coming?
I'm sorry.
Do you know your next GT already?
Oh yeah, I'm playing in Southern Assault here in at. Well, it's in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. I think it's going to be 40 to 60 people. But it's 3,000, no comp, no special characters.
When is it?
It's in July. It's the third week in July, something like that.
I'm likely to see the new book.
What?
Are they even rumored?
They're rumored to be Beastman? In the line. Like, there's three books left to get a hardcover, so expect them to be coming soon, unless they're not doing fantasy anymore.
Yeah, well, I was predicting a year and a half ago that Bertone would be getting their books, so...
It's 9 years. It's got to be coming soon.
Yeah.
All right, let me throw a Mallory question.
Some dude sent me an email last...
Go, finish.
Okay.
No, go for it.
No, Mallory's questions are...
No, they're really important. No, they're
they
not.
They take precedent. They take precedent.
What did someone email you? Finish.
Well, this was probably 2 years ago. This dude emails me like, "Hey, I want to start Bretonnia. What do you think I should buy?" And I'm like, "Don't buy them yet. There's a new book coming out, and you don't want to buy stuff now and have it not be good in the new book." And I'm thinking, that has been 2 years.
You and I was finding that email to respond.
You know, yeah. He has like eBay items. He's watching. He's like, "Damn it! I want to buy these so bad, but the book's coming out."
Yeah, when Spitton said not to, he must know something.
Yeah. He's on the internet. He has to know.
Yeah. I've heard that Games Workshop calls him up and asks him his advice about Bretonnians.
Keep them waiting.
I read that somewhere. I think it was on YouTube. I don't know.
Oh, good thing they don't call Anthony, though. Yeah. You have a thing or two to say.
Hey, fuck you, Games Workshop. All right, Malorian's questions. Let's do it.
All right, question number 3. What rules do you have for other YouTubers dating your daughters?
That seems kind of creepy.
So I've got two daughters. One of them is 19, so legal. And... She's just a beautiful girl. I mean, just beautiful. So sometimes people get drunk and start making jokes about dating her, and sometimes the jokes go too far. And so Malorian was a witness to that and saw my reaction. I'm like, at the end of the day, you're talking about my daughter.
Oh, man.
And so.
So did you just shut him down?
My only problem with her dating the people that make those jokes, I'm like, honey, I would be so disappointed with you if you dated that guy. Surely you could do better than that, please.
That's great, because then it's in her court. Like, you can, but I will be disappointed in you.
Yeah, I don't think she's been tempted for...
You know. I wonder if
Malorian had a YouTuber in mind, because I feel like at this point everyone's... I mean, for God's sake, Tyler's getting married in what, a week?
16 days.
Oh, man. Crazy shit.
Nice. Congratulations.
Thank you.
All right, so...
Yeah,
as
we just celebrated this last week. We celebrated my 21st anniversary. Awesome. I've been married longer than a lot of these people have been alive.
As if one question about your daughter wasn't enough, if one of your daughters wanted to start playing fantasy, would you let them... Or would you spend the money on Tomb Kings instead?
I'll answer that one seriously. I would love for my kids to play Warhammer. My son did it when he was 10 years old or whatever. My daughters have never expressed an interest. I would love it. I said there's dudes at the tournament. There was two guys there where their wives paint and or play with them. I'm like, I am so jealous.
Yeah, I played against Daniel's wife first game.
You lost against Daniel's wife first game.
Yeah. she's a good player. And the sad thing is, I don't think I think that was her first tournament.
It was. Yeah, it was like her first tournament game. She's like, oh, by the way, it's my first game, and then she schooled me, so.
Yeah. I'll go easy on you. She lays down like 12 skull crushers. Go to hell.
Yeah. 12 skull crushers.
Well, you know, one thing she was saying is, her husband is famous for bringing the nastiest net list ever, the high elf list from hell. And she's like, yeah, that's what I have to play against. Every time I play the game, she's playing against the toughest list, you know, one of the toughest lists out there. It's like, she probably is good, man.
What is the High Elf list from Hell? Is it the monster list, or is it the Death Star?
It was Daniel's list.
Death Star.
Death Star with, like, nine characters.
I hate that list. I hate it. He's such a nice guy, too. That's the most difficult list ever.
Well, with that thought in mind, question five. As king of the YouTubers, what is your first royal decree?
That everybody call me king of the YouTubers. I think that's my new moniker. If every time a Lorian wants to address me, I'm going to say, oh, stop. That's king. Go ahead.
Just Malorian, too. Just that Malorian.
No, I'm going to tell Anthony. I'm sure that'll go over well. Anthony. No, I'm sorry. It's king. That's funny. King of the YouTubers. It's so funny, man. This YouTube community has changed so much. It's freakish how many people are out there. So.
Yeah, it's growing. It's cool. How happy are you to see it grow like this?
You know, I'm not unhappy about it in the slightest. I think it's cool because for me, making battle reports is added to my hobby experience. It makes me feel out of the loop because I don't watch all of anyone's, and I probably watch on average one battle report a week. Period. It's just, you know, my time is taken up. And unlike a lot of people, when I work, I actually work. I don't sit around watching YouTube all day. So, yeah, that's my only complaint about it. I feel like there's this whole world going on in some ways I'm a part of it, in some ways I'm completely ignorant of it.
You know, it's funny. We started this show specifically for people like that. We were going to, like, prowl the internet and then make you aware of, like, the newest battle reports that are going on. I feel like we did that well in the beginning, but there are a shitload of battle reports. It gets to a point where it's just like, man, I can't watch these all. It's impossible. Unless I'm staying up 24/7 watching them, it's just impossible.
Yeah.
After Brawler's Bash hit, and like that week, there's so many reports, and I could, so go check out this guy's channel. He's got 8 new videos.
You know, I had an idea that I shared with Malorian and Anthony that I wanted to do, except I just knew I wouldn't have time to do it. So I'm going to give you the idea, and you have my permission to run with it if you want to. So what I think would be really cool for your show or a show like this is if people did watch all the battle reports out there, at least skimmed them, and every week did kind of like a news show where you didn't go over all of them, but you chose particularly good games, ones that were just particularly enjoyable. It was, you know, whatever it is you like about a game, if it's the visual aesthetic of it, or a game that was topsy-turvy, or that showed how to beat the Hellebron list, whatever it is, you know, and just highlight. You treat it like a news broadcast with links to the particular battles that you're covering. You say, hey, in this week, these are the top 10 battle reports, and you do that. I think that would be a hit. I think people would watch that.
That's funny because Tyler and I were talking about doing something like that, exactly like that.
After he said he'll give you the idea. That's funny. We already had it.
It's interesting because we top tens are very popular, and we're actually thinking about doing something very similar to that. But I do think that would be very popular because, like we were talking about, there are so many battle reports. How do you get through it all? And we wanted to do it on here, but we try to cover a lot of crap in an hour. And it's really hard to do that.
No, that show would, if you did a top 10 every week, that would take an hour for that show.
We would just need to find somebody that's watching all the videos.
Like, I guess I'm on right now.
Well, Lorian does watch all of them, surprisingly. Maybe we'll get him.
Now that he's out of Fort McMurray, maybe that's something he's going to start.
Yeah, I think now that he's out of Fort McMurray, he's not going to be able to watch as many as he used to. But I think that's the kind of... I can tell you that I would watch that, and I would use that to select what battle reports I was going to watch the next... Because I don't have time to watch all of them. And if I would look that for, hey, who are these new ones, you know, who's doing a good job? And it wouldn't have to be always be new people. You know, you might have an established YouTuber like me or Malorian or whomever that you know, had a particularly good battle report that week that you think is worth watching, you know, whatever. Anyway, so that's my idea. I hand it off to you, or if you don't want to do it, whoever's watching your channel can.
So if we do this,
to all the viewers.
So if we do this, should we do Once Bitten Presents? Like, Once Bitten Presents? Top 10 YouTube battle report.
Once Bitten Presents us presenting the top 10.
Yes. Once Bitten presents Long Island Wargaming presenting.
In honor of the king of YouTube.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. The king of YouTube's top 10.
Yes. This top 10 is brought to you in part by the. Okay, so yeah, we did hit our hour mark. So I think we're gonna be wrapping it up here shortly. Once Bitten, thanks again for coming back on the show. It's always a treat.
Oh, you're welcome. Yeah, no, thanks for having me, man. That was fun.
Definitely. Good. Anything else anyone wants to add in? Minus Dylan.
if I say something, it's going to go on for an hour. I'm sorry.
Hey, do you guys, are you familiar with the Dwellers Below podcast down in Australia?
I know of it. I don't listen to it. What are your thoughts?
I don't listen to any podcasts, but I'm going to go listen to a few of theirs because I'll be on with them sometime. Next week or sometime in the near future.
Cool.
So
yeah, once you do that, put that up on your channel or even on Google Plus, and we'll check that out.
And we'll plug it.
Yeah.
Cool. Anything, Tyler?
No, I'm actually really interested in these podcasts.
Tyler, will we see you next week?
Will you be seeing me next week?
Yeah. Is next week your last week as a single man?
No, I've got the 25th, and I've got 2 weeks of being single yet.
Okay. We'll have to have a send-off video.
Yeah, goodbye, guys. I can't play anymore. Yeah, we're actually thinking of... we all have significant others, and we're thinking about doing a special Warhammer Weekly episode with our girlfriends.
Calling it Living with a Wargamer.
So if the viewers are interested...
No, you need to have it
work in the pipeline.
Well, I think you need to set it up, and then you guys walk away and let them talk behind your back.
That's happened to me. My wife has picked up the freaking thing and talked to Tyler for 30 minutes, but I don't know what.
It was a good conversation.
Yeah, she got on and just started talking to us about Nick. It was pretty fun.
Yeah, for sure. So, yeah, that's what's in the pipeline, and Nick will sign us off.
Yep. Thanks for watching, everyone, and we'll see you next time.